G'day folks, welcome back to another episode. Thanks for joining us. Well, as promised, from one beautiful seaside waterfront location on the Exmouth epic Ningaloo Reef to the next destination we've pushed on to another waterfront seaside location. We've popped into a cute little historic township known as Cossacks. We're here for a few nights. We're staying at the settlers campsite, which is three night maximum here at this location. There are other sites among Cossacks that you can move to if you want to choose to stay here longer. It's $20 a night, love?
Yeah.
$20 a night, so good value, but you've got to be completely self-sufficient. You've got to have your own grey water tank, your own water. You're completely off-grid here for obvious good reasons. Check out that behind us. The tide is out at the moment. It goes out a long way here now, and the tide movement's going to be significant as we push further north, which I've got to be conscious of with fishing in the tinny particularly, because as you can see out there at the moment, she's pretty bare. You got probably a good 100 meters or so to even get into, dip your toes in some water. But the tide, when it comes in, comes right up here, probably about 30 meters away from us. I did go for a fish the other day. I flicked some hard bodies when the tide was coming in. I made my way around those rocks and eventually round to the other side. You can see the lighthouse in the distance there. There's some cool ruins on that island. There is a lot of history here that we're going to take you on a little tour this morning. We're going to go have a look in the township itself. So we'll share that with you because we're now making our way onto Pardoo Station. So we're going to share that with you as well as part of our travels. But really enjoyed our stay here. It's very quiet. It's very peaceful. It's by the water and super, super affordable at $20 per night. You can't go wrong. Would have liked to have got a bit more fishing done, but unfortunately that's not the case. Didn't catch anything because got some footage, but the water in here is pretty dirty at the moment. I had a few shark mackerels sort of following my hard bodies right up to where I was based on the land base rocks over there, but no strikes, no takers. But that's cool. We've got 5 days in Pardoo Station, so we're going to be sure to do lots and lots of fishing, adventuring, and sharing all that has to offer with you. I'll just share with you the sites so you can see for yourself. There's four sites here at Settlers Beach. They are pretty close to each other, but just enough so you can get your van in and your car side by side with your awning out. So, and there is a lookup out there that if you want to see at the right time with the right moons, you can check out and see the staircase to the moon, or stairway to the moon. Anyway, we're going to pack up. We're going to share with you a little bit of Cossacks Township itself, and then onwards and upwards to Pardoo Station. Here we go. Yo, let's get going. All right, so just outside of Cossack Township here, there's this European and Asian cemetery. A lot of history here. I'm going to share with you, come on a little history lesson with us. Now I have to read this because there's a lot to try and remember. Mel put together this cool post about Cossack on our Facebook and Instagram page, yeah, love, the other day. So I'm just going to share with you what she put up because it was really knowledgeable. Cossack and Settlers Beach. Cossack, formerly known as Tien Tsin, obviously Asian, is an historic ghost town located 1400 k's north of Perth and about 15 k's from Roebourne in the Pilbara region of West Australia. Cossack was the original port of pearls before the luggers moved north of Broome in 1886. That's how old this town is. An early hub for gold prospectors in the region and a port of pastoralists in the Pilbara. Following the opening of Point Sampson, which is just behind us, jetty, the town was dissolved in 1910 and absolutely abandoned by 1950. So there's a little bit of history. Let's jump in there, have a look at this European Asian cemetery, because we love our history, don't we, love?
We do.
Now, it says on the sign there that a lot of the headstones you can't read because obviously all the sand movement over many, many years has worn away at them. But these actually look fairly readable, which is cool. Yeah, check this
so
out.
Some people weren't buried here. Some people were laid to rest either on the beach or in the water.
Wow.
But yeah, these were some of the people buried here. And they were more of the Asian, European and Aboriginal.
Well, look at these ages. Like this person here, born 25th of December, 1825.
passed away, unfortunately, in 1895. William Shakespeare Hall. What a great name. That's a strong name, isn't it? So that must have been the European section back there. And then we've got the Japanese section over here. So they've separated the two of them, the two nationalities. The Japanese have got it quite good. They're a bit closer to the water here. View's quite nice. So here's a memorial by the looks of it. And as you can see, a lot of the writing has worn away through sun, wind, and obviously sand as well. All Japanese writing there. Wow. That one's lasted. Beautiful to see this Japanese writing on these stones, the way they are. So I thought I'd just share with you real quickly, Cossack Township is just down there. I don't know if you can make out that roof there. These are the Butcher Inlet campsites. There's this one and there's one further up near the lighthouse up there. You can see these campsites. I believe they're the same cost. Don't hold me to that. I'll drop the link below to make the booking online so you can find out your own info. But yeah, this is more on the inside inlet of the river here. Good sandy sites, probably a bit bigger, these sites. And yeah, what is there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 sites, I think. So not too bad, and you're a bit closer to the township. Okay, so we've arrived in Cossack Township itself, and I'm gonna show you the first building that was believed to be erected here in the 1800s, which was the customs, post office, chemist, and bonds house. But just next to that is this incredible, incredible building, which would have been stables by the looks of it. Or purling. Yeah, these just look like massive, massive sliding stable doors. But I haven't seen the sign explaining what this building is exactly, but it's absolutely stunning in here. Big sliding door there, these big stone walls, high pitch cathedral style ceilings up there. Look at the size of these beams. If these walls could talk, I'm sure they'd share an amazing story. But now I reckon she's set up for functions, I'd say. A wedding, reception as such. Yeah, be pretty cool having like a outback rustic Cossack style wedding reception here. Anyway, stunning building, big, nice and cool in here, eh? That's because of the thickness of the stone walls. Like, Demi, stand next to that stone wall and look at the camera. Face on. It's wider than your body. Width. Look at that. That's how thick that stone wall is.
Are you calling me fat?
No, darling. I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about the stone walls. 12-year-olds. Ooh. Girls, especially. So this is inside the post office, customs and telegraph house and bonds place that I was telling you about. Beautiful and cool in here. I mean, again, look at the thickness of these walls. There's your window trimmings. Look, you've got over my hand size in width, that size, and probably the same on the other side. Hence why it's so nice and cool in here. Beautiful historic building. Drop in the comments, folks. Do you guys love history as much as we do when you get to old townships like this? Whether it's from seeing cemeteries or historic buildings, just reading about the past history and just immersing yourself almost to feel a part of it. What was it like to be alive in that era? Drop in the comments and let me know if you get as excited as we do about history. Anyway, I better find the girls, see where they're up to. All right, so this one's a bit of a mixture. It's the police barracks, yep. The cook-up, yep. And the lock-up,
hence the door. So do you come here for a good meal or to get locked up, or both? Yeah, of course. Wow, Cossack police quarters, lock-up and service buildings. There's a picture back in the 1897. HMS Cossack, Tien Tsin, Harbour, 1871. How cool is this? Get in that cell, you little troublemakers. Cossack Jail, or Gaol, built 1897, restored by Hemsley Iron Proprietary Limited. So Dampier Salt Operations Proprietary Limited.
They would have been chained up to these.
Possibly. Yeah. Those anchor points.
Yeah.
Oh, hang on, we got ourselves a troublemaker here. You doing some time? What was your crime?
Being too pretty.
Oh, well, that is a fair crime, little lady.
I'm in here for 5 minutes.
Can I?
Not bad, particularly as you're becoming a teenager. The only way to keep the boys away.
Eh? Can I come in?
No.
Okay, I'll have a look at this one then.
It's literally the same thing.
Wow, these doors are solid. Again, look at the thickness of the wall. Not too bad. Not too bad of a room.
I'd say it's a 2 metre by 2 and a bit metre. You could get a double ensemble maybe in here. I'm sure back in the day, very simple, basic living.
So in total, there's 1, 2, 3, 4 cells. So, yeah, cool. Awesome, what do you think?
I'm out.
Oh, you're out. Freedom!
So number 6 is called the Galbraith Store. So it was advertised as being merchant shipping, stock mining and general commission agents who also bought and sold pels and pell shell. It was based in the southwest, therefore building can be said to be present to take over the northwest frontier by outside interest, as people who came to the northwest in the 1860s died. They moved south or were simply bought out. Ownership of the northwest industries changed.
Awesome.
So let's go in.
Have a look. Beautiful store. Galbraith and Co. Man, the stonework is just like phenomenal, hey?
Yeah. It's amazing, isn't it? Watch your step.
Yep. Wow. Look at those beams. Phenomenal.
So we have to remember that some of this, because it was ghost town and abandoned such a long time ago, that some of this has been restored to its condition today. So.
Well, it was. It was abandoned in the early 1900s.
Mm.
1910, I think, if I remember. Yeah. You can tell the roof has been restored, absolutely. Anyway. We've got one more building to look at, folks, and then we've got to hit the road.
We'll just say from here,
yep.
You can see the old courthouse.
Yeah.
So that's obviously where
that building over there.
The criminal business happened,
you
know, with the jail and all that.
Yep. And the courthouse is now being turned into a museum as well. So I think you can do guided tours here as well. I've just seen a fellow chatting to a big group of people and telling them about the story by the sounds of it. So not too sure, like I said, we'll drop that link in so that if you're ever up this way, you want to check out Cossacks. Pretty cool, cute, quaint, historic little town by the water. So you can get some fishing in, of course.
And like I was saying before, like the beauty about traveling is coming to spots like this that aren't even on our bucket list.
Yeah.
You know, like I love history like this. It's real cool. But we're going to go and look at the Tien Tsin lookout.
Yep.
Which is a little bit of a walk, but you know, that's our exercise for the day. So go and have a look.
So we're at the peak of Tien Tsin lookout. Before I flip the camera around and show you the amazing, incredibly stunning views from here, check this out. This is their water tower, obviously. Tank, have a look at that old Asian painted mural there, holding what looks like to be a queenfish, I reckon. By the looks of it.
No, it looks like tuna.
Nah, it's not. Might be, yeah. I think. Yeah.
Look at the...
Could be, yeah, tuna, queenfish, one of the two.
I know my fish love.
You do love. That is sexy. Anyway, check out. Oh, look out. That's just where we were, the courthouse. That merchant store there. There's a telegraph home just there. and the post office and chemist, and the jail's just behind that. Settlers campsite is just over that way, that hill. There's those campsites, the butcher's inlet there that we're talking to you about. And here's that inlet. There's that wharf where, if you're ever down this way, have a fish off there. That's a hot tip where old mate got the blue bone, apparently. Obviously on the inner coming high tide.
She's pretty low at the moment, but you can see from the ocean, Point Sampson over there. Sorry about the sun, folks, if there is a bit of sun, to the inlet, to the inland. What a stunning, stunning spot Cossacks is. Like I said, wasn't on our radar. We just literally dropped the pin on Wiki Camps. Thought we've got a few nights to break up between Exie and Pardoo Station. Stopped in here, no plans. Beautiful spot. Wish we could stay longer, but we're booked in from Pardoo tonight. If you can, I'd suggest, particularly if you want to get some fishing in here, stay three nights at Settlers, stay another three nights at Butcher's would be my hot tip, because it's very, very quiet and peaceful. All right, so we've just pulled into Port Helen, or we've just pretty much drove through Port Helen, fueled up.
Driven.
You know what I mean. Check out this freight train, right? So it starts way down there, if you can see.
So there somewhere?
Yep, and then all the way along. There's two more engines just here. Two more engines. And then it just continues on. We might be here for a while yet. Look, I can't even see the end of it. That's nuts.
There it is, I see it.
That is the biggest freight train I've ever seen.
I've seen bigger.
Woo-hoo!
Train
chug. Woo-woo! Jugger. Woo-wee!
Are you doing that for anyway. Slack?
You know, yeah, that one's for you, Slacky. Toot toot. Are you on there, brother? Is that you? Are you captaining that train? Is it captaining or piloting or? I don't know, driving. Anyway, just thought we'll share that with you because that is massive. Until we've been in the car for a little while, we're a little bit stir crazy. Pardoo, 1 hour, 28 minutes. See you there. G'day, folks. Well, as you can see, we've made it to Pardoo. We shall go. I don't know why I felt like doing that, but anyway, we're at Pardoo Station. As promised, we're here for five nights. It cost us $250 for a family of three, two adults, one child, $50 per night. That includes power and water. We'll drop some details down below here somewhere about Pardoo Station. We're going to get the tinny off. We've got some pretty good weather over the next sort of 4 to 5 days. A bit windy in the morning. Big tidal movement here, so just got to be super conscious of that. We'll share the beautiful sights and scenery around Pardoo. We've already unhitched, set the caravan up, but we had to head to Pardoo Roadhouse because Chris-O forgot to fill up the tinny jerry cans of unleaded fuel. So we got the boat, we just didn't have any fuel. So we've got some fuel. We'll show you the campsites. So far, it's great fuel, great vibe. They've got some activities on offer that they do in the evening. Yesterday, they had some music around the campfire that people could sit around. So we'll show you some of that. And obviously we'll get out into the little estuary and lake system and a little bit out wider as well, pending the winds and finding my feet with the big tides. But anyway, kick back, relax, let's get into Pardoo Station. Let's do it. All right, folks, so we've just launched off Pardoo Station boat ramp. We had to wait for the tide. It's literally still pushing in. The boat ramp's just behind me. It's literally like a chain reaction of boats coming out at the same time. Everyone's looking for the tide, the incoming tide, because pretty shallow through here. We're at about 0.8 of water. And there's a boat behind us. A couple of boats in front of us as well out there. We're headed out towards the mouth. The inlet mouth, where it meets the ocean. And I'll show you the boat ramp when we get back there. It'll be a bit fuller because the tide's coming in at the moment. It's about a 6-7 meter difference in tide. At the moment, there's a turtle just here. Anyway, let's get out there and hopefully some tight lines, bent rods. We're predominantly going to be chasing, I think they call it blue face threadfin salmon. So let's see how we go. So you can see we've just pulled up to the mouth here, the inlet mouth. Some blokes fishing up the bank over here. Tinny's out here. There's the ocean.
a few more people back here. And today we're targeting some blue threadfin salmon. Whatever else comes in through here, I'm sure there'll be sharks and all sorts. Had a few small little bumps, but nothing to write home about so far. More just bait pinches. Gonna maybe get out wide if the wind drops off a bit. Still a bit blowy at the moment, coming across northeast. And something small here. Little whiting, staying deeper. Ah, little thready. Bluey. Hey mate. You see why they call them the blue nose. See that little nose? Beautiful looking fish. Beautiful looking fish. There you go, mate. I've got one so far, wouldn't mind maybe one more. Just have enough flesh to cook up tonight. I'm looking forward to it, guys. Drop it in the comments below if any of you have eaten blue nose threadfin before. Be my first time tonight, I'm looking forward to it. People absolutely rave about it. So I've only heard good things before about them so far, eating quality wise, but let me know if you've tried them before in the comments and what your thoughts are. Love to hear from you. It's one of the things I'm really enjoying about coming to new destinations is catching all these different species on offer to try, taste, feel how they fight differently. So that there, folks, what we're after. Blue nose threadfin salmon. Up here in this part of Western Australia, there's no legal size limit. I think the bag limit's 4 a day. Beautiful colour, hard fitting, hard fighting, good on. Good on like gear like that. That was on prawns, so let's get another one back out there. I'm literally, I've only got bigger fishing gear at the moment because I've been doing a lot of offshore fishing out wider. As you guys know, I'm literally using a whiting hook pretty much because I only had, the smallest hooks I had was 3-0s and I was getting lots of hits. But I couldn't hook them because the hooks were just too big. So anyway, we'll get this one back out there again and see how we go. And we're on. Another blue nose, ready. Bit small again. Oh. Well, you might be my second keeper, I reckon, mate. Follow the hook, good and proper.
So that was a little bit of the track out from Pardoo Station out to the boat ramp here. The boat ramp itself is only a couple of clicks, and you know when you get there because everyone else is doing the same thing, timing their run with the tide. There is a gate that you have to go in and through. Don't let that divert you. I'll show you that gate now. Someone's going through as we speak. They're holding it open for us, doing their good deed. So check it out. So just head on through the gate. And then you'll see everybody pretty much doing the same thing at this time because you have to time your run here with the tide as it comes in.
you hook around to the left, and then you get down to the boat ramp down here to your right. And how many have we got here today? There we go, we've got a few fellas down here ready to roll. A few people fishing off the beach already. All right, camera down. I'm gonna get ready and we will unhook the tinny. So that's the boat ramp just there, just launched.
Couldn't show you as I was launching just because I'm a one-man show at the moment, but you can see you pretty much just drive up, drop it in just on the edge of the water, and then you swing your tinny nose around, into the water you go.
So yeah, that's Pardoo Station Creek boat ramp. Anyway, let's head out there and get among it.
So as you can see, you can walk down, folks, come fish by the water's edge. Obviously the tide will start filling up there pretty quickly, but there's a track behind those folks on the bank there that you can walk to. You can see some people walking in the distance there back to their cars, but you've probably got a limited time with the incoming tide. Hoping to get out wide tomorrow. The winds are backing off, but we're at the tail end of the moon phase, so I think it's not even, yeah, probably 15-20% wax given, so there's not much tidal movement at the moment, and it's where you need water coming over there so you can get across that bank there over to get out wide. Oh, good hit then. Oh, we're on here, I think. No, dropped him. Baited. So again, we are out here to catch some blue nose threadfin. And if we get a reasonable size whiting, we might hang on to it this time. All right, this is it, folks. We've got a big bait out here. Got some squid on, just with a 4-0 hook, seeing if we can get something a bit bigger. This is the last session, though. We pack up and leave tomorrow. We head off to Barnhill Station. Oh, and we were hoping to get out wide today, but as you can see, that wind's come on shore, and it's about 10 knots more than what it should be, and you can see it's rippling up inside here. You can only imagine what it's like outside. Oh, look at that big bit of squid I got on there. Just unweighted, 4-0 hook, probably too big for what we've been catching in here, to be honest with you, but just let it sit, see what takes it, eh? Had all the rods rigged up to go out wide today, but just swapped over now to the lighter gear. Give me a bit more of a chance to get in and pack up when we get back. Really got to time it here. It's sort of top of the tide is at 4:30. So you pretty much, if you're going out today, I've only got, it's 1:30 now in the arvo. So if I went out, I'd have to be back in about 4:30 in order to get across that bar across there before the tide starts swinging back out again. And I'm down to my last muley's bait. Prawns are all gone. This is it. The last dance with the gents. Yeah, we're on in. Little, tiny, tiny, tiny. Prawn seems to be going a lot better than the muleys, but they don't last as long on.
Oh yeah, that's a good one.
You all right, folks. That right there.
Yep.
Another broom. Big one, bigger one, this one. Ew. Jeez, they fought good. How big is this one on the odds? Not bad, 26 centimeter brim. Ew. Beautiful colors. For another day, mate.
Well, folks, that wraps up another episode. Thanks again for joining us always. We hope you enjoyed that cute little historic town at Cossacks. If it's not on your map and to-do list to visit, get there. Beautiful coastal little town, cool history, lots to see and do. And then Pardoo was great staying there, very peaceful, great people. We've met people that have been going there 20 to 40 years every year consistently. That's how popular and how much they love it. Unfortunately, the fishing wasn't as good as we would have liked, but it was the back end of the tides. The moon wax gibbing is about 5 to 10% at the moment. So unfortunately, couldn't get out wide. Just the tides were getting less and less as the days went on with movement, and getting across that sandbar to get out wide, it just wasn't deep enough. However, stay tuned because we are packed up. At the moment, we are on the red dirt. We're going to hit the black stuff, the tarmac, because we're headed north up to Barnhill Station, which everyone absolutely raves about. So next episode, make sure you follow us. If you haven't already, make sure you subscribe, like, comment, share, whatever. Give us some love because we're going to take you to Barnhill, about an hour and 20 minutes south of Broome. And so many people I've spoken to have absolutely raved about this joint. So thanks again for joining us on this episode. Sit tight, stay tuned, because next episode we're taking you to beautiful Barnhill Station. Let's do this. Let's hit the road. Yoo!